Camera set. Background.
Figuration.
Action.
I was sitting on my couch watching an A&E biography of Julia Child. You know, I was thinking, what a great love story this is, the Paul and Julia story. And subsequently, a book came out called My Life in France, which Julia Child had been working on with her nephew, Alex Prudhomme.
Well, My Life in France is a book about Julia and Paul's favorite years of their life that they spent together in Paris in the late 40s and early 50s. When Julia learned how to cook and learned how to speak French and began to write her first cookbook.
I was about to turn 30. I thought that was the end of the world. I was working, you know, a series of disastrous temp jobs. All of a sudden, literally woke up in the middle of the night and said, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm going to cook my way through Julia Child's Mastering the Art of French Cooking, and I'm gonna do it in a year, and it's gonna change my life. I was talking to my husband about it, and he said, that's a really good idea. What you should do is should start a blog.
All of a sudden, that kind of producer light bulb went off in my head, and I went, you could combine these two things.
These stories work so well together. I mean, Julie Powell's dedication to food really came as a result of Julia Child's dedication to food. And I think Julia Child transformed herself by her dedication to food. She made herself into someone else through food.
We went out to the studios in Hollywood, and the first meeting we had was with Amy Pascal. And Amy was, I've never had a meeting like this before. She wouldn't let us talk. She just said, I'm buying this. I'm buying this. I love this. I'm buying this. Could we tell you our ideas? No, I'm buying it. And she said at the first meeting, Nora should direct this.
It's about love, it's romantic, it's about marriage, it's about changing your life by writing. It's about doing things you love, doing things you care about and finding happiness through that. There's just a million reasons why I had to do the movie, but I started out with a very simple reason, which was food.
Butter.
Well, Nora Ephron's been writing about food since the 70s, I believe, and really knows her material.
She's a great lover of Julia. She's a lover of food.
She is a foodie. She's a very thin, she's the thinnest foodie I've ever seen. She eats little bits, I would imagine, and has a good metabolism.
I really honestly don't think there's anyone who has had her finger on this notion of the role of food and family and food and life the way that Nora has.
I'm a big fan of Heartburn, and when I heard that Nora was coming onto the movie, I thought instantly of Heartburn, and now she's gonna be able to get this, both as a foodie, as a cook, as a passionate eater and creator of food, but also as a strong woman who's known about tough spots in life. You know, she has an understanding of crossroads, and she has an understanding of New York.
The movie on the modern side is a Valentine in a certain way to a different kind of New York than she shot before, the grittier New York, New York outside of Manhattan.
I started out by just taking notes, just pages and pages and pages of notes.
She had printed out my entire blog, which is big, and you know, I had notes in it, and she was asking me, you know, hard questions about, this really happened like this?
I like writing about real people because you know so much about them. It's not that Julie Powell and Julia Child are alike, but that their lives followed a kind of deliciously similar pattern. I knew that I had stories that were gonna kind of interlock with one another.
I just don't know how Nora does what she does. Her deftness as a writer and how secretly she sneaks in what it is she's talking about when you're just watching what you think you're watching. It's a gift for subtlety.
Nora has an incredibly strong vision of the movie.
You always feel as though she knows this character, so I tend to turn to her when I'm stuck to say, what is this with Julie?
What she did, which was kind of great, is she let us play and improvise. Nora's incredible at comedy. It's no big secret, but she knows comedy.
The film is very, very funny, but it doesn't set out to have any jokes. There are no buttons and there are no ba-dum-bum. you know, sort of moments. You laugh with these people, but you feel for them as well.
One of the things I was shocked to learn when I read all the biographical stuff about her was how romantic her marriage was.
What if she hadn't fallen in love with me?
And how sexual it was.
But I did.
He was an older, experienced man, and she was a, I'm sure, thought she would be a spinster forever. And they fell madly in love.
And when you talk about passion, Julia Child didn't just have a passion for her husband or cooking, she had a passion for living.
From the get-go, in Nora's mind, Meryl was the person who really had to step into these shoes. She is both an iconic figure and she's playing an iconic figure.
I'm Julia Child. Bon appétit.
Anybody who gets to direct Meryl Streep knows that it's about as good as it gets because she's so prepared. She knew so completely what she wanted to do as Julia. When you're directing her, you can kind of go like this a little bit, but basically it's there. It's all there.
She has such presence as Julia, and she brings the physicality of Julia. Even the way she bends and moves her body is so Julia-esque. She's a marvel.
Her characterization of Julia was unbelievably accurate. And she said the two of the things that she focused in on were the voice and the gestures of a tall person.
Julia Child was a larger-than-life character. So while I felt a responsibility, certainly to her memory and the legacy of the great work that she did and to the essence of her character, but I'm not really doing Julia Child. I'm doing Julie Powell's idea of who she was.
She has an uncanny ability to both suggest Julia Child and imbue the character with the spirit of Julia Child, and yet it's not any sort of impersonation of Julia Child. It is a beautiful, beautiful characterization.
Working with Meryl is, you know, one of the greatest experiences ever because she's really funny and she's really talented. Her concentration is extraordinary. I mean, you never know what she's going to do on every take. And that's the thing that makes it so exciting.
It was astonishing having the fun of making a movie with her.
Right now, you are so not under the influence of Julia Child.
Julie Powell is more like me than Julia Child is. I mean, Julie Powell is a person who weeps when things go wrong and is a little melodramatic and gets a little bit carried away with, you know, she's human.
She cooks her way through mastering the art of French cooking, but it's what she learns through doing that. The mistakes she makes, the people she hurts, she gets kind of caught up in the idea of results.
Is it bland?
Not anymore.
Thank you for telling me that. You almost let me feed Judith Jones bland bouff bourguignon.
Here she was in this ratty little apartment in Queens, cooking these very complicated recipes, and it gave her a real purpose.
I was just purely trying to make, I don't know, a space for myself in my own life.
I think just by the sheer repetition, by the sort of devotion and dedication to the act of, you know, making food and eating food, she found herself in a way that she didn't know when she started.
You know, when I was 29 was kind of a big year in my life, and I was trying to decide what I was going to do. And it was a crossroads for me, and so when I read the script, she was 29, she was at a crossroads, it was something that spoke to me very strongly.
I'm 30.
Sort of feeling a little lost and really having to sort of turn inward and figure out who you are and kind of go through these disgusting struggles that we have to go through in life. And that's something I really identified with.
What I liked about Amy was that I could believe, first of all, that she was a writer, that she was not from New York, but could live in New York.
Amy has a grace, but a intrinsic intelligence to her as an actress that is working really beautifully for the role.
I was very excited when I heard that that was the casting. Amy is adorable. She's completely, completely cute. She, you know, she's tiny. but that's okay. I like to be played by tiny people.
She's really one of my favorite actors that I've ever worked with. She's completely present And in the moment, you can throw her any curve and she'll go with it and throw something right back at you.
You know why I think it is? ADD.
You have ADD?
Yes. That's why I'm so bad at housework.
Both the men that these women were married to loved this thing their wives were passionate about, were not threatened by it, were completely supportive. Those guys loved that they got to eat all this great food. Paul probably had a better time than Eric, because as Julie says in the movie, Julia Child probably did not burst into tears every time something boiled over.
To the public, he was a peripheral figure, but in her life, he was the most important person.
He's such a strong partner to Julia, and their marriage is a marriage of equals that isn't just romantic love, although there's that, but it's also just respect.
The old phrase that behind every great man is a strong woman, well, in this case, it was the other way around.
I mean, he adored her, and she adored him. He would do anything for her. And food was the thing that just cemented it over and over again and sort of allowed it to grow. Living in Paris doesn't hurt either.
I would like to tell you it was my idea to cast Stanley, but the truth is that when Meryl called after she read the script, she said Stanley has to play Paul Child. And I thought, well, of course, why didn't I think of that?
You at least have the book.
It's your book, too. It is. Without you, it wouldn't be a book. Not that Simke and I'll ever be done with it.
Someday you'll be done with it.
I'm beginning to wonder.
He looks exactly like the real Paul Child, and he's a great actor, and he loves food.
Oh, he's a wonderful man and extremely funny. A little too funny sometimes, because I will laugh on camera in the parts that are not supposed to be funny if he sets me off, so that was a problem. But other than that...
It's so rare to find men who support women so graciously.
Julie and Eric's relationship has a little more modern conflict in it. It got hard for Eric. So much was happening to her.
And do not write about this in your blog.
About what?
About this fight! I'm out of here.
They have their ups and downs, and they get through it.
He's a rock, you know, in the best way that husbands can be. He's calm when she's crazy. He's logical when she's crazy. He loves her when she doesn't necessarily pay him the sort of attention that one would deserve. And I think that that's really important for her, and she comes to realize that in the film.
Chris has really done a fantastic job being supportive and helping her with the idea and then saying, enough already. He's both charming and funny, but he has a kind of strength to him. And he's brought a sexiness to it.
You have to have a lot of sex on the side.
They just met. I can't imagine Dorothy running off with Ivan Cousins.
Dorothy McWilliams is Julia Child's sister, and she's her younger, much taller sister, believe it or not. She's 6'5".
My mother was kind of a force of nature. My father was an absolutely wonderful piano player. She first met him when he was playing the piano. He looked up at her and he said, "Have you thrown any pies in people's faces lately?" He recognized her from 10 years before. He said, "I was sitting in the cafeteria. The tallest, most beautiful woman I'd ever seen in my life came out of the kitchen with a cream pie, threw it in someone's face, laughed hysterically, and left. It had been my mother." And he recognized her that many years later.
This is the first time I've actually played someone who lived. And, you know, I was able to get from the pictures a real strong feel for the joy and the happiness and the enthusiasm for life. So I was really happy to have that, and I hope I brought that to the character.
I started working with Terry, and I thought we had something. And then Terry started working with Chris, and Chris sort of took over that relationship.
It did come between us for a little bit, but...
we worked it out.
Yeah.
When he's on set, it's all about Terry, quiet for the cat.
Well, and he also has this thing, like, he likes it really cold on set, so we've been, like, freezing. But he's a great actor, and he studied at the Lee Strasberg Theater Institute, and he's...
he has a bit of an attitude.
He does, but
I only
laugh
because I'm uncomfortable.
Yeah.
He's method.
Well, one of the things I said to the actors was, everybody has to eat in this movie. I know there are a lot of takes, and I know there's going to be a lot of food, but this is a movie about people who talk and eat and talk, and it can't be that you're sort of gauging yourself the way actors sometimes do. This is about people who just, in the middle of the most horrible crisis, might mention offhandedly that the oysters are really good. So the actors were great at that. I mean, they just ate and ate and ate.
What I did is I didn't eat all day. So then when I got to those scenes where I had to chew my way through, I was starving. But I learned that early on.
I don't know how he does it. He makes it look, he's eating like a man, but yet it's not grotesque. It's a talent.
Fortunately, the food was good. So, but still, a certain amount of acting is required because at some point, you don't want that third portion of bruschetta. But, you know, poor Crispicina had to have about 12 portions.
But after 32 bruschettas, I can get a little crazy. That day, in fact, we had a bucket ready for me to puke, but I didn't.
This is good.
Mm-hmm. I don't remember really anything else that where I didn't feel good about what they were eating. I mean,
we haven't gotten anything sent back. We had an amazing food expert on this set, Susan Spungen, who literally had an entire tent set up on stage E at Silver Cup, where she prepared all of the food.
We have a wonderful improvised kitchen. One electric stove, 3 electric ovens, a million pots and pans.
Yeah, it's electricity and running water. If you have those two things, you can pretty much cook anything.
She and her staff have just beautifully created this food.
The food just looks delicious. It was something that Nora was very adamant about, is these beautiful shots of these beautiful meals.
I think Nora used the word pornographic at one point to describe the level of what the food should be in this film.
It isn't just about making it look pretty. Nora has made people share the food, and the relationships depend on sharing the food and the connecting over food.
The lobsters were incredible. That was my favorite, the lobsters.
Like lobster with mushrooms, potatoes, and like sauce, baked. That was pretty good.
And then, of course, you barely see it in the movie, but everyone is eating it, and it was delicious. It was really delicious.
Some of it's pretty heavy. We're having like a duck pate tonight.
One thing you have to say about Julia Child's cooking is that it's retro. It is full of butter, it is full of cream, it is not spa food.
I ate a lot of food, but I never got to, I'm like skinny fat right now, like I'm skinny, but I'm really flabby. But maybe that's too much information.
15 pounds. That's it. Yep. It took about a year and a half to get rid of him.
I think what Julia Child was trying to sort of encourage people to do was to make these grand meals so that you would have a grand occasion to share them. If you did it as part of your everyday life, I think it brought people together.
Amy, I don't think, is a cook, but she took a lot of lessons and turned herself into a completely believable cook at the Julie Powell level.
I cook at home, but I cook a bit like the Swedish chef from The Muppets and not at all like Julia Child. So I had to sort of figure out how to hold a knife, which is still a challenge for me because I like to put my finger on top of the knife.
Meryl did not need a lot of training. She did know how to do most things.
I can cook dinner, but I didn't really know what I was doing. I did try to learn how to chop onions, but I stopped doing that because Nora said, your eyes are too red.
Chopping onions, it's not my talent, that's for sure. I think we might have had a hand double for me. Meryl did her own onion chopping. I think that's important to note.
Ta-da!
I'm much better at it, but I'm certainly no Meryl Streep.
The idea of food created out of love and passion, whether it is the best thing or not, is always satisfying for the recipient and the maker. And it's important that sort of joy, the simple joy, should be taken in everyone's life.
Everyone who sees this film is going to go, where are we going for dinner? Where after the movie? It's a movie that makes you hungry.
It wasn't just the presentation of the food, it was the implementation of the food. And so, of course, it informed everything that we did. I think there were 14 kitchens in the movie that we built. I knew what Julia's kitchen looked like. We just replicated it as much as we could, down to a museum. I mean, the tiles, the stove, the sink, everything, because it was just great. We wanted to contrast that with Julie's kitchen. The real Julie Powell's kitchen was actually a little bit bigger than the one that we built, but you could see how it would have been difficult for her to get through this cookbook in the kitchen that she had. It was a lot of fun to figure out what would be the visual elements that would tie Julie and Julia together. We used the same colors. Literally, it was the same color paint. Gold touches that appeared in both places. Windows helped to inform all of the built sets, compositions with both Julie and Julia standing in front of a window with just the sense of light that comes in.
We shot many, many of the interiors in New York.
We had two stages. We were shooting in one while we were building the next.
Julie and Paul's apartment was a fabulous set.
Well, I went on the set and was met by Nora Ephron and her set designer, and the first thing they wanted me to do was go see the apartment, the sets that they had done. They were absolutely perfectly reproduced. It was like walking into the photographs of Julie and Paul's past.
I designed most of the apartment from two photographs. In a way, it's Julie's idea of Julia. So it's given us a little bit of license to make it a little bit brighter than it actually would have been in post-war Paris. When Julia actually moved to Paris, it was wintertime, and it was cold, and it was bleak, and there was snow, and there were fires everywhere, and there was a darkness to the city. And we're here in June, so there was a lightness that we brought to the film.
We're using streets in the Left Bank. We're recreating. We'll have period cars. We're doing all exteriors there to give us the feel of Paris.
We are on Rue Mouffetard, which is one of the classic market streets of Paris. The basic architecture and narrowness of the street got us halfway there, and then we were able to come in and add the right facades and the cobblestone and the incline and the roof lines and period correct food and a number of butchered carcasses behind me, which seemed to be doing all right.
And to be on that gorgeous market street, surrounded by these amazing looking French people in Anne's costumes, that was just bliss. It was complete bliss.
One of the tougher jobs on this movie, because it is in a way two movies rolled into one, is the role of the costume designer. And fortunately for us, we had Anne Roth.
Anne does part of your job if you're the director for you, because she really believes that costumes and character are so intertwined.
Well, I like being in the fitting room and helping an actor make his character. That gives me great pleasure to take a long time, figure it out, end up in a big mess, and then suddenly something kicks in and the character appears in the mirror. There are some actors, you know, who say, well, I don't like to wear yellow. And you think, well, honey, I don't care whether you, we're not talking about you. But then there are actresses like Meryl and many actresses who realize it's not about them, it's about the character they're creating.
It's so delightful.
She was a hardy girl who was 6 foot two. We made four or five pair of experimental shoes.
They look like Herman Munster shoes, basically, but she always puts nice fabric on them, and they make Meryl probably 5 or 6 inches taller than she is.
And so all the fittings were done with that height, with that length of leg. We cheated on where the waistline was. We cheated all over the place. And we made a figure that was what I saw as Julia Child. Her clothes are high quality. There's a lot of embroidered monograms on her pajamas and on her blouses. Her jewelry was lady jewelry. Her clothes were lady clothes. And then, of course, her husband was this perfect smaller person. Very dapper. His suits were made for him. Not that he was rich. He was never rich, but he thought he was spiffy.
The suits are beautiful from that era, just gorgeous. And you traveled in a suit. You know, I flew here in my pajama bottoms.
Lower Manhattan Development Corporation, Julie Powell.
I was very, very devastated by the World Trade Center. Fashion was not something you thought of at that time, ever. For the next year, it just was a mush, a blur. So I relaxed and said that I wanted it to look mudgy and blurry, not particularly as a fashion piece.
I think the period's been recreated beautifully by the designer and the costume designer, but also by Stephen Goldblatt, DP. It's romantic without being sentimental. It's very uncomplicated. and yet you get the essence of everything in a single shot or two shots. I think that's what Nora had envisioned, and here it is.
One reason I wanted to work with Stephen was that he'd worked with Meryl before, and they loved each other. And I also knew that he has photographed a lot of women, lighting women so that they look good. Even if they're young, it takes someone who really understands that's part of what he has to do. And Stephen had lived in France, and he wanted to do it, and he was great.
The story of Julie and Julia is something that Julia Child would love, because Julia Child always thought of herself as a teacher, and she loved to transmit her knowledge to others. She loved sort of transforming people's lives in this way.
She gave us the idea that delivering this beautiful food to your family or to your guests was an act of love.
I mean, I would have said when I started it was about learning how to cook, but what it was about at the end was challenging myself to live, I don't know, bravely and actively.
If you want to practice being fearless, what easier way to do it than when you're cooking?
I think this film has a huge feeling of hope after World War II and after 9/11. Both of these women were rebuilding, and it's never too late to rebuild one's life.
It's about partnerships and how you can support each other in good times and bad.
For me, it's always really been a movie about transformation. It's really about how you can take control of your life and put it on a set of rails that you know, you're heading towards destination that you want to go.
I hope that this story can be both a fun movie and a delicious movie that's going to make you want to go out and eat, but also something that may inspire particularly women to say, you know what? What do I really love? And what can I do with that and make something of my life and try to pursue it?